You're listening to Get to Know World of Warships, a podcast created by Boggzy and Sinpax.
Alrighty, folks. Clan Battle Season 11 is over. I'm relieved. That was a lot. Carriers are a lot. And coming up here this week, we have the Verizon Tournament Tier 8. We talked about it last weekend. It's popping up right here. I have a very special guest. I don't know if you can hear that. That's the heater in my house. God damn it. I'm not restarting this. Verizon Tournament coming up this weekend. Get there. Be there. Do it. Tier 8. 9v9. No carriers. Get your Akazukis ready. Get your Lenins ready. Let's all remind ourselves how much we like it when there's no CV. Giddy up. Let's go talk with Kelsier about the Smaland right after this clearly non-satirical message. Hi, I'm Boggzy McLaughlin. Will you be an angel for a helpless Smaland? Every day, innocent DDs are bombed, torped, and rocketed, and they're crying out for help. Please, click the Twitch link below and join the Boggzy SPCA with a monthly gift right now. For just $5 a month, only 17 cents a day, you'll help rescue DDs from their abusers and provide damage, PR, win rate, and love. Sub or follow online in the next 30 minutes, and you'll receive this welcome kit with a photo of a Smaland in a shelter right now. One who's been given a second chance, thanks to you. Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, I have a very special guest. I know I say they're all special, but those were all lies. This one's actually special. I have here to talk with me and you about why the Halland, excuse me, not the Halland, the Smaland. It's the sister ship to the Halland. Why the Smaland is awesome and why you should consider getting it before it leaves some point in the next 2 months or so, I would say, from being able to be purchased for free XP. So please welcome Kelsier 3, or is it Kelsier, or is it Kelsier XYZ? Which Kelsier are you actually? Because there are several.
My first account was Kelsier 3. I tend to just go by Kelsier. The problem was that someone already took it, played like 50 games in, I think, Akirov, and then never played again. So my main's Kelsier 3. 4, 5, 6, and 2 are alts, though 4 is the main alt.
Now, I've seen Kelsiers in other high-tier clans as well, I think, unless these are you in disguise. Is there another Kelsier that you get confused for, or am I just confused?
If you've seen a Kelsier on NA, it's probably me, or someone playing on my account. Or not my account. There are a few that are like mine. But back when I think we were running the Zhaos. Like, Kelsier 2, for example, is just a dedicated Zhao bot, which is kind of funny. As soon as we got it, or as soon as we grounded to the Zhao, Zhao became not meta, so we couldn't use it anymore. But most of the counts, if not actually all of them except two, are 100% mine, and if you see him playing, that's probably me.
You got it. Okay, good to know. You are here partly because you have the... You have some of the best stats, if not the best overall stats, it depends on how you gauge it, in the Smaland on North America. And normally, as we all know, stats mean nothing, of course, but the fact that you've been with Gaishu and friends, you've been in the clan that constantly changes its name, whether it's Yikes, E-Boy, E-Girl, Kiaru, Mauled, CV Bad, am I missing any? What else has it been?
Oh, we've got a list. I keep track of it, actually.
Okay.
We're up to nearly 30 or 40 at this point.
Good lord.
We actually tried changing it recently and found that we couldn't, so we're trying to... I think Gaishu submitted a bug report.
Yes, he did, and it was on the CC Discord, and I saw it, and I think I realized what the mighty Gaishu's Achilles heel is not being able to change the clan name.
I think it would be kind of funny if Wargaming hard-coded, like, 35 or 40 different names a clan could have, and they just never thought, no one will go over this, right? And then here we are.
I mean, it's entirely possible that somebody just put it in an arbitrary number while they were, you know, setting up that...
setting up that tree and just never went back.
Like, they've got to put some number, right?
Yeah, they got to put something.
40 sounds like a good one until, someone tries to go to the 41st name change.
Right. So we're going to talk here about the Smaland. Now, a little quick history about the Smaland as a real ship. The Smaland was actually a real boat, along with the Halland, which is also in-game and is actually a real boat. They were actually two Swedish Halland-class destroyers that were made. There were supposed to be two more. Never got around to building them, probably because they were like, we're Sweden, what the hell do we need boats for?
One's overpowered enough.
Yeah, one is overpowered enough. So, fun little fact about that. And so, Kelsier, I'd like to ask you to give me what I call a log line. It's basically means if you had to describe this boat to somebody else to give them as much information in about two sentences, how would you go about doing it?
Smaland is the DD Exterminator, the king of cap contesting DDs. If you can't outgun a DD, you outspot it. So you can 1v1 any other DD in the game.
Okay, that is good to know. And I think we're going to get into more details about that, because there are some destroyers that can technically... It can technically outgun you, but it's such a close call that if you are capable enough, you can end up winning that fight properly. So then, if this is the DD Exterminator and the Cap Contester, is that its primary role in terms of what a DD should do at Tier 10? Is this, if you're taking this, is it like taking a Khabarovsk? Is it taking a damage farmer? Is it taking something that literally your job is to take a cap? Or is your job to hunt down the DDs? What's your job?
The Smaland is unique in that it can play a lot of different roles in terms of destroyer play. Like, if you want to kit it out like a pseudo Kleber, you can. I don't think it works as well in that role. Why not just take a Kleber at that point? But some people like to have the radar on their pseudo Kleber, right? I do think that it plays best as a DD contesting, DD killing, cap contesting, spotting kind of ship. But it is versatile enough that you can play it as a damage farmer or anywhere in between. Oftentimes, when I do play it as the DD kind of exterminator role, after all the DDs are dead, you transition into the BB farmer. So kind of just, it can do both. It can do a whole bunch of roles in terms of destroyer play. The only thing it can't do is torp boat, which torp boats are dead anyway, so... Sad to say.
fair enough. So then I think before we go on, we should probably find out from you, because there are a couple of different modes of thought about this. When you play the Smaland, at least let's just say for randoms first, when you play Smaland in randoms, what are the unique modules that you choose that someone else might not? And then what's your captain build?
In terms of modules, I think that it will really depend on how you want to play it. Because I play it for DD killing, cap contesting, I take stuff like concealment, and I think I took the speed boost too. Yeah, the special speed boost mod.
Mm-hmm.
But if you're going to be playing as the pseudo Kleber or pseudo Harugumo, right, you might want to take range mod or the extra consumable duration mod instead of stuff like concealment or the reload mod.
Sure.
Please forgive me. I don't know the words for all these things.
That's okay.
For years, but
that's okay.
I don't know the terminologies very much. But because you can play it as the BB farmer or the DD killer and anywhere in between, there's a lot of versatility with the kind of modules that you can take. But those are the modules that I take. And then with captain skills, it's the same thing. You can take concealment expert or you can take AFT. If you want to be shooting DDs all game, BFT over DE. If you want to farm battleships, take DE instead. I think the core skills for Smaland, regardless of what else you're going to take, would be SI, because the extra heal speed is huge.
Mm-hmm.
SE, because you're a destroyer with a heal, so why not get even more heal? And last stand, AR. Those are the 100% essential. Everything beyond that, you can kind of decide where you want to go. I personally go for BFT and CE. Mm-hmm. But you could argue for RPF, you could argue for DE, AFT, just whatever works for you.
Sure. So I'll just contrast this with the build that I tend to use, and I'll preface this to everybody listening by saying I am not as good as Kelsier is, so don't listen to me first, listen to him first. I end up running with the, module-wise, I take the Obviously, I take the concealment mod just for that extra dispersion. You know, the buff to, I guess the, I don't know if to call it like a buff to your incoming dispersion, or whether they're like, I guess it's a nerf to enemy dispersion or whatever you want to call it.
Makes them miss more.
Yeah, makes them miss more. Just that, to me, that effectively increases your effective health pool.
Or worst possible case, makes them miss just right, so their one battleship shell lands right on you and you clearly miss.
Yes, there is always that possibility. But then I take the DPM module at the end, along with, in my captain skills, I take AFT to push my, that pushes, if you take AFT, that pushes the range out to 13.6, which means you can technically stay outside of the 12km radars and still farm. Do you just sort of just say to yourself, who cares, why would I be going after 12km cruisers?
Oh, usually the 12km cruisers, with the exception of Nevsky, have pretty long reloads. Moskva's kind of short. Nevsky's like hyper danger mode, but stuff like Stalin and Tallinn and what are the other ones? I think that's it, right?
Yeah, Petro.
12km radar? Petro. Petro's kind of fast too, but Petro radar is like half a second. He will get two salvos on
yeah,
if you want
it.
To go dark. You can just dodge that. But if I need to fight cruisers, I'll just fight them at 12 or whatever the range is. That's one of the disadvantages of taking the full DD killing kind of build.
Right.
Is that you are now quite a bit closer. No, I don't notice it much with the radar cruisers, more with the secondary battleships.
Ah, that's a good point.
Because you can dodge those all day when you're shooting at 12 kilometers, their main batteries, but when they just click on you and continuous damage just comes in, that can be a bit disastrous.
Right. So to surmise here from the builds, it sounds like if you want to be primarily a DD hunting, then you take full concealment and you take essentially survivability, so that, you know, once you get into that gunfight with another DD, you'll win it, you'll survive it, and you can generally heal or speed boost away from it later to preserve more health. Was that about right?
I think that regardless of which role you play it as, you want to take as much survivability as you can. SE and SI I would take on every kind of small build.
Got
it. Just because even if you're playing as a 13.5km BB farmer, you're mm-hmm. going to take damage. And your, I guess, meter of how you can impact the game is your health bar. If you're low health in Smaland, you don't have any tricks with smokes or... well, really just smokes.
Yeah, right.
Any tricks like that. Or torpedoes as well, right? If a DD lives on 2K like a Shima, it's the same as a 20K Shima. Actually, it's probably stronger because now you're shooting torps off all the time. Same with Sommers, same with a lot of other destroyers. But with Smaland, when your health is gone, you have 8 dinky torps and no smoke. So your ability to impact the game is your health bar, regardless of what kind of role you're playing. So I think max survivability for every role.
Fair enough.
For BB farming, you'd go range or more range, just so you're not within those ranges where you'd get smacked. But if you're playing for DD killing, you're going to be closer than 10 anyway, so
yeah,
no issue there.
Well, so considering the fact that I think everybody listening would agree that BB farming is pretty straightforward, you can either sit behind a rock where they can't see you, and you can just rain fire up to 13.6 kilometers, or farther if you're crazy, if you want to take both range apparatus. But BB farming is relatively simple. You sit behind a rock, you shoot, you light fires, then you shoot at something else, or what if you...
BB types in all chat.
Yeah, BB types in all chat. Exactly, right. So, but the DD killing is considerably more complicated because, like you said, in the Smaland's bag of tricks, one thing that it lacks is smoke. But it has two very specific tools that it uses that are relatively unique to it, and one of those tools is a 30% short duration, extremely powerful speed boost, and the other is a 7.5km radar. So, let's just start with the radar for the listeners who might not know exactly what this means. How a 7.5km radar and a sub, it's like it's 6.1 or 6.2 with full concealment, and then it's 6.8 with...
One of the two. You can tell it's a radar ship because neither of us know.
Fair enough, yeah.
If you're lit, you just press the radar button, you get to the killing, so
right.
It doesn't really matter what the conceal is.
So run the audience real quick through what exactly that radar does for you when you are contesting a cap or when you run into another DD.
It is the radar trap. If, for example, you are playing, let's say, Daring, another ship that's pretty good at cap contesting, lots of damage, has a heal, has a quick smoke, hydro, so you don't die to torps, if you're playing that and a Shima reverses into you, you can either use your smoke and then probably get radared because it's randoms, or you can sit there and die. You can't touch the Shima. If he gets smoked because he was diving straight in, you can't do anything about it. You have to rely on your team in a randoms game, yeah, right, to radar him so you can actually apply damage. When you are playing Smaland, if you are lit at all, you press radar and you start killing whatever just lit you. Unless it's another Smaland, then it's a toss-up.
So the critical thing there to take away is that as long as you are running one of the concealment modules, either the concealment module or the concealment captain skill, you have stealth radar capabilities, which means if you get lit and it's not from someone else's radar, if you get spotted by another ship, you can press the radar key and you will see it, which means that you can immediately start shooting at whatever, especially if it's a DD, you can immediately start shooting at whatever is spotting you. I think that's the critical thing right there. And then the speed boost is unique as well. And so there's a lot of differing opinions in my understanding of it, of when to be using the speed boosts. The speed boost is a 30% speed increase, which comes with a massive boost in acceleration as well, arguably the most important part about it. So when do you find yourself most commonly using the speed boost? Is it specifically for dodging? Is it for relocation? Is it both?
It'll depend on the game. If, for example, you got into one, let's say, the far westernmost cap on a map, you killed two destroyers, and you've got three boosts left because you used one of them during the fight, you can probably use that to relocate. But if your boost is up and you're taking a fight, especially against a destroyer or a cruiser with faster reload, you should probably just hit it. In general, you have enough of them with SI and premium consumables, now that those are standard, where you can just hit it whenever you take a fight that's in any way serious.
Right. So most people listening, one thing I've found out about my podcast audience is that the majority of my audience is actually folks from the higher tiers of competitive clans. I always find it interesting to find out who responds to things. And so most of them are probably going to understand what that speed boost means for juking and what that means for dodging shells and essentially mitigating damage. Would you, for those who don't, because the podcast is starting to reach the storm level and gale level clans as well, which is always sort of fun to hear the questions that come from that. How exactly is it that this speed boost, besides just hitting the gas and just running away, how can you use this effectively to essentially dodge fire?
The way I kind of visualize it is, like, take your ship, right? Any ship. This could be small and could be anything else. Mm-hmm. And imagine all the different positions you could be in 5 seconds. That includes behind you, it includes in front of you. If you're going 30 knots, you're not going to be able to slow down to reverse in that time. If you're turning, you're not going to be able to turn as widely as you might otherwise been able to. But with Smaland and most other ships, but Smaland, when you have a speed boost on, most other ships with a speed boost, rather, let me say that. When you have that on, you are able to completely relocate your ship from basically a dead stop. Like, you could, in 5 seconds, reverse far enough where you're not even in the same position at all. And a lot of players, especially in randoms, tend to aim where you are at the moment, or where they think you're going to be based on how nearly everyone else plays. So if you can use that speed to just do things that they don't really expect you to do, like when a BB shoots, you just reverse. Or when you are reversing, just stop or keep reversing or do whatever. It allows you to shift where your ship is almost by the entire length of your ship in that 5 second span. So when a BB shoots at you, you can easily just dodge every single shot he shoots.
Right.
Same with Stalin, same with nearly every other ship. The only issue is the ones that reload quickly. Because as soon as you start moving, you restrict where you can be in the next 5 seconds or so, right? But that speed boost, what's really good about that one, or Smaland specifically, is you're not restricted anywhere near as much as you would be with, say, like a Daring. If a Daring reverses and dodges the BB shells, it takes him about 10,000 years to stop reversing and start accelerating again. And so Daring is very bad at doing that kind of reversing dodge, and it limits that 5 second kind of image of where it can be. Smaland's not limited anywhere near as much as any other DD, except maybe Kleber and Marceau. Mm-hmm. So it just has the ability to dodge so much, which is necessary, as it has no smoke.
Right. Well, and that's really the key thing to juking that I've gotten a little better over the last 6 months or so. The key thing to juking I've found is about oftentimes accelerating just enough to make it seem as though you're full forward and then hitting the brakes again and then going forward again. So you're just constantly, you're sort of constantly adjusting where your opponent thinks you're going to be. I think you were basically just describing there. And I've noticed as well that making a full reverse to full forward or full forward to full reverse, that takes a lot of time, whereas a little bit of turning, a little bit of acceleration, a little deceleration tends to do a bit more in terms of throwing off aim. Would you say that's about right, or have I missed the mark on that?
I tend to do pretty drastic dodges.
Mm-hmm.
Really, it depends on the kind of player that you're playing against, right?
Okay.
In a randoms game, you could sit perfectly still and just stare at the dude, farming him. Let's say it's a Montana at 12, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you can be sitting perfectly still and he could still shoot in front of you. So you just and you'll be fine. But with better players, oftentimes they'll aim where they think you won't be able to get out of in that 5 second period or so for the shell travel time.
Mm-hmm.
So in those cases, those little adjustments can be used really, really well to trick them. Like start going back for literally half a second and immediately start going forward again.
Right.
And really good players, because they're good, will see that and think, oh, I've got this idiot, he's dead, and shoot behind you. But by the time that he actually kind of processes that and gets transmitted to his keyboard so that the shells are in the air, you're already probably stopped reversing already and probably accelerating again. So you can use those little adjustments to try kind of trick players, especially good ones, the ones that are actually watching where you're going.
Mm-hmm.
Probably shouldn't have said that.
I mean, what do you think you're doing here, brother? We're here to pick your brain and steal your secrets. So, let's talk a little bit about, like, pragmatically in the four most common game modes, which is going to be it's going to be randoms, which we've talked a little bit about now. I'd like to transition into ranked, clan battles, and COTS. Specifically, you guys, Gaishu and friends, currently mauled, hair loss critical. I believe, unless something changed, you guys ended up
trying to change it.
Not even number one NA, but I think you beat Smile by 1 point, right? To be number one global. I think you guys are 412 and Smile is 411.
I think so.
Okay.
I don't remember the exact numbers, but I know it was just one over. We played 3 games last session and saw, like, Smile's probably not going to log on at 5 a.m. Russian time to play on the NA server.
Right, probably not.
So we're good here. And then we went to go play Scriblio.
God bless you guys. So I'm curious to know if you folks in the top ever ran the Smaland this season of clan battles, if you even experimented with it, and if so, what'd you find?
We did not, actually. I do not think that Smaland operates anywhere near as well in a team format. It's still good. Still very good, in fact. But it's very good when there aren't carriers.
Okay.
Because if, for example, we played against plenty of Smalands, and we were running Smalinks at one point.
Mm-hmm.
Smalinks. And I was playing Yuyang on a rock on some cap, as I often find myself, and I saw, oh, my RPF's out here. So I just told whoever's in the carrier, go fly over there. And lo and behold, there's a Smaland 9 kilometers from double smoked Smalinks, and he just died.
Right.
Like, he died in 20 seconds. He can't do anything about it. And to play Smaland effectively, you have to play in the face of the other destroyer, which works fine when there are limited radars that you can see on the screen when you start. Like, there's 3 radars and you keep track of where they are, and the carrier player cannot just decide, I'm going to fly over and end your game.
Right.
So in a clan battles format, I don't think Smaland has a place.
It,
not really.
Yeah, it definitely felt, I mean, I would almost argue that there's one serious culprit for why, if there's a carrier in clan battle format, the Smaland, you know, barring some strange gimmick that they put in, like a 6 kilometer storm, you know, or whatever, 6 km spawning range due to cyclone, barring some strange, silly gimmick, the carrier is just, the Smaland has good AA, but it's not good enough to tell a carrier, you cannot come near me like a Halland can. And even with the Halland, the FDR, which recently introduced, the FDR can literally loiter over even the heaviest AA destroyer in the game, much less a Smaland. It can loiter over it and just keep it lit so that your tools to survive are effectively completely nullified.
Yeah, we did the same thing with lots of Halands too.
Yes, I recall. Thank you.
No smoke DDs. I mean, you played Halland, right?
Yes, I played the Halland almost the entire season.
Yeah.
And I recall.
It's even worse than the Smaland, I think.
I mean, because it works so well in so many situations. You know, I think that most of the folks, because FDR is new enough, most of the folks running FDR or MVR just didn't realize that the Franklin Roosevelt planes, you can literally park them on top of a Halland and you can just keep it lit while your cruisers kill it. Most were too afraid.
I would smoke and shoot most of the time too.
Yeah. Most would just be too afraid. They would. I remember opening up on so many. I'd keep the AA off in the Halland until essentially the FDR planes were right on top, and then I'd open up because you're already spotted. Might as well start chipping away at his AA. And oftentimes they would instantly recall, and I'd go, "Thank God, this is a win," because they won't keep me spotted. But unfortunately, Gaishu and Yamamoto were the two that I would most commonly run into on your team playing FDR. They wouldn't do that. They'd just go, "Hey, look, I found a DD. Everybody, kill it."
Yeah, they have a realization that it's not a randoms game where you have to like apply the damage yourself and preserve your planes for yourself for the whole deal. If they lose a squad to take a DD down to 10% health, that's more than worth it.
100%
worth it. And they realize that.
Yeah. So
one actual extra benefit of Smaland in randoms games mm-hmm. is because of that same mentality for a lot of random CV players, they see Smaland and think, Swedish destroyer.
Right.
And they just never come near you. They just leave you alone because they think you're going to destroy all their planes. But they don't realize it's decent AA, sure, but it's not a Halland.
It's not decisive AA is the key thing. Yeah.
Unfortunately, decent AA doesn't really do much.
It cuts it.
Get struck three times in a row.
It cuts it in randoms oftentimes, but it does not cut it in top tier clan battle gameplay for sure. We did see a whole bunch of Smalands, though, in COTS, in this last season of COTS, COTS 11, to the point where, I mean, when I was casting, I feel like the Smaland may have been the single most banned ship from the NA tournament. I mean, did you? I don't recall if you folks brought Smaland or not, or if it was mostly you guys brought Marceau. Guys, you played Marceau, and did you guys ever even consider bringing the Smaland? No carrier.
They might have. It was no carrier for me. I didn't actually play that COTS.
Oh, you didn't? Okay, forgive me.
I don't personally. I don't really like COTS as a game format. Like, I am part of Yikes, which is what we still call it,
mm-hmm.
but I'm not in it because I like the competitive aspect of this game. I like clan battles. I like to be able to sit down and play a bunch of games with friends for like 4 hours.
Mm-hmm.
I don't like sitting down with a bunch of friends waiting for 30 minutes for a streamer pack to get finished.
Yeah, sure.
And then we all load in and there's a DC, so there's a mulligan, and then we all go back out and go back in. Like, I understand that the competitive format four games can be fun for people to watch or to people to play, but I'm just not one of those people. I don't really even watch tournaments.
Fair enough, brother.
It's just, so for a COTS format Smaland game, it's no CV, right?
So far COTS has been the crown jewel of those who seek refuge from the oppressiveness of hot sticky death from above. Yeah.
If that is the case, then Smaland would work pretty well. Not as well as it does in randoms or ranked, just because those are individual modes where mm-hmm. having all the radar and the speed and all the things in your toolkit lets you just do whatever you want as your own player. But when it's a team format, it's still very useful to have those tools, even if you do have a Stalin radar in range that you know will pop it if you yell at him enough.
Sure. Yeah, absolutely. Makes sense to me. Do you like bringing it into ranked when it's a tier 10 ranked season?
I will play nothing else.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Good lord.
I was grinding my ult in clan battles to get free XP for the Smaland so that I'll have it on both accounts. Both of my big accounts, I guess. just in case, right?
Yeah, both of your big accounts.
I do not want to lose it.
I don't blame you. Well, you know, that's wonderful. I'm going to ask you to do two more things before we end here, but I will remind everybody, the whole reason we're talking about this and the whole reason Kelsier was nice enough to donate some time and some vocal power to this was that the Smaland is being removed from the tech tree. You're not going to be able to purchase it for free XP anymore in the next coming months. I honestly don't know how long it's going to be, but the they have made an announcement. Wargaming made an announcement that sometime in the near future, it'll be removed and replaced with something else. So consider getting it. It's really, really, really good. It's also very unique, as Kelsier has kind of illuminated here. There are so many things that it does that other DDs just don't do. So do yourself a favor and get it, because it's a lot of fun. So this, I mean, this is sort of like an outro, I suppose, kind of like the opposite of a log line. But when you pull in a Smaland, what's the first thing you do when the game starts? Like, do you check the lineups? Do you see what you're going to be most useful as? What's the first thing you do generally?
First thing is take the ship, point it straight dead center at the closest cap. Dead center because you want to be efficient, right? You want to get there as quickly as possible. And then you just, you go. You go to the nearest cap and you start killing everything, essentially. Something that's very overlooked, I think, in terms of destroyer gameplay is the kiting advantage and the ability to secure that kiting advantage going into a fight. So something that I actually do is bow in like toward the closest cap, right? Mm-hmm. Go straight at it. But about 20 or 30 or seconds or so before you actually hit the cap is when I tend to hit the speed boost before the fight's even started. Because if you do that, you're going to beat everybody else into that cap. You can get into it, get turned out, and then the randomest player, Shima, is chugga-chugging all his way straight towards you, coming bow into your turned-out Smalan 2 minutes into the game, and you just kill him.
Sure.
And you take very, very little damage because you're not in a position where you're running face-first into their team, having to turn out and taking tons of damage. And so you just kill him, you take very little damage, and you're good to go. The alternative being that the Shima doesn't come there, and you just get a free cap, which, I mean, that works too.
Is this why I keep seeing Shimas die in the first 3 minutes? Are you responsible for this?
Well, not just Shimas, but there are where I think the most fun I had in Smaland was going into a camp and there were three DDs and I just killed them all. I think it was like a Benson, a Shima, and a Gearing. And the Benson died to guns, the Shima took torps, and then the Gearing died to more guns because you don't stop shooting.
Yeah, it... You know, whenever someone asks me about the Smaland, I describe it as, it feels like a muscle car, like a drag racer or something. Like, it feels like a muscle car that someone finally outfitted. They put, like, guns in the headlights, you know? Where it's just this ridiculous, absurd, silly flex. And it's got such incredible gunfire, rate of gunfire. It has decent torps, especially for killing other DDs that decide to smoke up in front of you after your radar goes down or what have you. It just... It does that, and it does it so fast and with such prejudice that's sort of how I tend to describe it myself. I'm learning some new things though myself about how best to play this, and I appreciate your candor. I suppose the last thing I'm going to ask you to do is sink a ship, Mr. Kelsier. If you had the opportunity to take one ship into a cap, and you basically get to pull a small land into that cap. They're like, oh no, a Smaland, I better smoke up and sit in it. You get to obliterate that ship. What is the ship? It could be anything. It doesn't have to be a DD. I'm sort of just being silly there, but
you
like...
You know what class it's going to be.
Not class. You get one.
You know what class it's going to be from.
Rather. That's fine. Which
you
one?
Already know.
Which one?
Richtofen. Richtofen.
And why is that? It's not the FDR. It's the Richtofen. Okay.
It's not. Carriers are exceptionally powerful. Overpowered, you might say, as a general class, but Richtofen is egregious even more than its compatriots because it only does citadel damage that you can't heal back. So imagine you're playing a thunder,
yeah,
that gets obliterated by AP bombs, right?
Right.
Midway bombs you, shit sucks, right? You're down 20k, it feels like, but you can heal like half of it back. It's awful, feels real bad, but you can at least get struck four times more before dying.
Right.
Richtofen comes and triple AP sits you. What do you do? You can't heal any of it. You can heal 2k of that back.
Yeah.
And it's so it's an extremely oppressive ship that restricts a lot of the cruiser and battleship choices whenever it's in a game mode. Like with this past season of Clan Battles, for example, it's like, should we run DMs? No, they die to Richtofen. Woosters dies to Richtofen. Smalanks, we can run those in their smokes. If they're ever outside of their smokes, dies to Richtofen. Like, it just eliminates so many ships.
Well, Stalin,
for example, Richtofen dies to it. Stalingrad dies to it.
Mm-hmm.
Montana's dies to it. I think, yeah.
Yeah, there's pretty much only
two... It
does
things that other carriers don't.
There's pretty much only two non-smoking cruisers that don't just immediately get obliterated by Richtofen, and that's Petro and Goliath. And it's mainly because they're more, not completely, but more resistant to the AP rockets, which do Citadel damage, which you can't heal back. And
crazy how those were the only two cruisers used in substantial amounts this season.
Crazy, right?
Right, like it's just the fact that it restricts a lot of the compositional variety is what I don't like about it. It's as overpowered as other carriers, but it restricts more than the other ones. So I'd like the most to see that gone.
Consider it gone. By the power invested in me, I remove the Manfred von Richtofen.
I mean, it could also be mitigated by Citadel's not dealing unrepairable damage. Personally, I think every ship in this game should have repair, and Citadel damage shouldn't be a thing where you can't repair anything back.
I see.
That would be a very drastic change, and I'm not part of the balance team. So
maybe one day for Christmas I'll get my wish. Fair enough, brother.
Like maybe one day I'll be part of the balance team, and that is, I surely hope not.
Yeah, right. Well, congratulations to you and your clan on, I believe, unless I've got this wrong, and I'll be very embarrassed if I did, but global number one. That's a very impressive feat. Thank you for dedicating your time to me here. Is there, you mentioned before that you do have a Twitch stream. I'll put the link to that down in the description below. Is there anything else you wanna plug before we sign off?
Nothing. I'm not much of a socialite on this game. I tend to just open the game and start playing.
Right. So that's fine.
I don't really have many things that I could possibly plug. I mean, I joined one clan and stayed there for 2.5 or so, maybe 3 years now. And before that, I was in the sub-clan for boats, if you remember that clan, called Hotel.
Oh, yeah.
So that was a while ago.
That was a while ago.
But
I think that might have even been before I was really... I think I might have been in my first 1,000 battles when that was a thing. So
I probably was, too.
Well, obviously, you made inroads into the more competitive side of things, because you're up there at the top, brother. So thank you very much.
I got scouted.
Yeah. And thank you all very much for listening. I appreciate you giving your time as well. So I'll see you on the next episode of Get to Know World of Warships.